Let's pray, and we're going to look into God's Word. Father, we thank you for your Word, and we ask that you would teach us this morning, that you would instruct us, that you would encourage and challenge and correct if necessary, but Father, that we would get the message, that your Spirit would work in our hearts so that we would see and hear and be receptive to that which you have for us. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. At the end of August 1973, now that's a long time ago, I was sick in 1973. I had a blood disease and had spent a couple weeks in the hospital and spent a lot of time at home and was laying on a couch, couldn't go to school. And so I was able to, well, I should have been doing my studies, but I was watching TV. And I was there to the end of the baseball season. And I was a Mets fan in 1973. And at the end of August 1973, I was very disappointed because the New York Mets were solidly in last place in their division. Now, some of you can't even remember back that far. I understand. Okay, some of you weren't born then, so just follow the illustration and we'll be fine. But at the end of August, with only 1 month left to play in the regular season, they're in last place. Nothing good was going to happen to the Mets. But over the next 21 days, the Mets experienced one of the greatest comebacks in baseball history. In 21 days, they fought their way from last place to first place. So that on September 21st, they defeated the Pittsburgh Pirates and won the National League East Division Championship. I was ecstatic. They lost the World Series. It's all right. When it was all over, the Mets fans were calling it the Great Reversal. While the manager of the Mets, baseball legend Yogi Berra, simply said this, and maybe some of you remember what he said, "It ain't over till it's over." That quote has been used ever since to describe those kinds of situations in which, when all appears to be lost, a great reversal takes place in which great victory is snatched from what appears to be the jaws of devastating and sure defeat. It ain't over till it's over. And this is what we see take place in Genesis chapter 3. When Satan, who is in the Garden of Eden, deceives Eve so as to successfully tempt Adam and bring about what we refer to as the fall of man. I mean, in the first 13 verses of Genesis 3, we have bad news. Really bad news. Because it really seems as though Satan has won the day. Adam and Eve have been placed in this beautiful garden, this great creation of God. Everything is perfect. They're perfect. Everything is good. But Satan is in the garden. And he tempts Eve. And then she tempts in turn her husband. And Adam eats. He's the representative of the whole human race that is to come, all of their descendants. And he falls. And God had told him, "In the day that you eat from this, you will die." But Adam and Eve did not believe God. They chose to believe the serpent, and there was great devastation. He truly did die spiritually, and then that was going to lead to their physical death as well. And so the first 13 verses of Genesis 3 are bad news. Satan had succeeded not only in tempting Adam and Eve to sin, he had in effect stolen their allegiance, their loyalty, and their affections. It's not all about a piece of fruit. It's a whole lot more than a piece of fruit. Satan stole their allegiance, their loyalty, their affections. The fall entails all this. It was not merely about eating fruit. It was not just a simple act of disobedience to God, as bad as that is. It was not simply the pursuit of wanton, selfish ambition at the expense of obedience to God. Or just Adam and Eve foolishly thinking they knew better than God when it came to what was best for them. We don't ever think we know better than God, do we? About what is best for us? No, Adam and Eve's sin, while all of those things, was in fact far more than those things. Their sin was nothing less than mutiny. It was their shot across the bow of God's sovereignty. It was their shot across the bow of God's throne. It was their declaration of independence from God and from God's authority, which was exactly what Satan was hoping for. You see, Satan's temptation of Adam and Eve was his means of capturing their affections, their loyalty, their allegiance, their adoration, and even their worship. Satan's primary target in the garden was really not man, it was God. Man was simply Satan's means to get back at God. And tempting man to choose obedience to Satan over God was Satan's way of trying to destroy God's prestige, His glory, His honor, by seemingly dismantling God's plan, by ruining God's people, by replacing God with Himself as their primary authority and their ultimate source of happiness and meaning and significance. Happens every day. In other words, the fall of man was essentially the twofold sin of forsaking God and replacing God with Satan. That was it. Jeremiah makes the point in Jeremiah chapter 2, verses 11 and 13. Go over there very quickly. Jeremiah chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. It's really a powerful passage, and he sums up what we do every time we sin. And I love the passage, and I only wish that I had two sins that I've ever committed in my life. Listen to what he says. In verse 11, he says this. Jeremiah 2, verse 11. Has a nation changed gods when they were not gods? But my people have changed their glory. For that which does not profit, be appalled, O heavens, at this, and shudder. Be very desolate, declares the Lord. Verse 13. For my people have committed two evils, two sins. Again, I wish that that's all I've ever committed was two sins. But you know what? What he's going to tell us is that every sin you and I ever commit falls into this category right here. If you boiled all of our sins down to two things, here they are, right here. Every sin. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, to dig for themselves cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. He says, every time you and I sin, we're rejecting God, we're forsaking God as the only one who can give us what we really want. Who can give us the happiness and the joy and the significance and the meaning that we crave. We're forsaking Him and we're putting all of that heavy, weighty stuff on some act, some thing, some act of disobedience to God, and we're saying that's where we're going to put our happiness. That's what we hope is going to give us what we're wanting. And God says, it's a broken cistern. It can't hold what you're trying to put into it. God is the fountain of living water. He's the fountain of joy, the fountain of happiness. Believe it or not, for some of you, you're going to be really surprised. The Bible says God is the fountain of all pleasure. All sin can be broken down to its irreducible minimum to forsaking and replacing God with that which is not God. All sin. And that's what happens in Genesis chapter 3. The fall is much more than eating a forbidden piece of fruit. It is forsaking and replacing God as man's source of all that is good with Satan and all that is bad. And the fall was the most destructive, cataclysmic act in history which has produced and resulted in everything that is wrong with man and the universe. Everything that is wrong is traced back to the fall. But as bad as it all seems and as bad as it is, the fall is not the end of the story. Genesis 3, 1 through 13 is the bad news, but it's not all the news. You see, there is good news that follows the bad news, and we see it in Genesis 3, verse 15, which is where we're going to spend the gist of our time today. So let's read Genesis 3, 15. Follow as I read. After the fall has occurred, God has confronted Eve. He's confronted Adam. He's confronted Eve. He is pronouncing judgment on the serpent, who is Satan. And in verse 15, he says to him, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head. You shall crush him, or you shall bruise him on the heel." That is the judgment, the prophetic judgment that God pronounces against Satan. And we need to unpack this to understand the significance of what God is saying. Now notice that the verse starts with, "And I will." It starts with God making an "I will" statement. I will do this. This "I will" is a response to Satan's five "I will" statements in Isaiah chapter 14. "I will ascend above the heavens. I will set my throne above the angels of God. I will be like the Most High." And so here in Genesis 3:15, God responds to Satan's "I will" statements, and he says, "I will do something. And my I will cancels out all of your I wills." And it does. He says, "I will do something. I will," and here's what he's going to do. Here's what he's going to do. "I will put enmity between you and the woman." Now that's where we start. And on the surface, it doesn't seem very significant. But here's what we have to understand. Enmity is not loyalty. Enmity is not allegiance. Enmity is not affection. Enmity is not adoration. Enmity is not worship. You see, all the things Satan thought he had won in successfully tempting Adam and Eve to sin against God, which would have been the universal, worldwide affection and loyalty and worship of Adam and Eve and all their descendants worshiping Satan, was not going to come to fruition. It's not going to happen because God is going to create enmity between the woman and Satan and between the woman's seed and Satan and Satan's seed. Whereas Satan thought he had won the whole human race that would descend from Adam and Eve, God says, "I'm going to turn a portion and really a huge portion of the human race against you." Enmity is not a word that is applicable to animals, by the way. Animals don't have enmity against animals or against other people. Enmity is the Hebrew word evah. It's talking about deep personal animosity, hatred, antagonism. That which is totally in opposition against, but it is always used of morally responsible beings. People who understand what that is. We're not talking about something that is instinctive. So God is not saying that He's putting a hatred of snakes in people, or a hatred of snakes or a fear of snakes in women. So we come to this and we say, well, this is where we get this whole thing where women are afraid of snakes. That's really not what that is talking about. This is why the human race doesn't like snakes. That's really not what this is talking about. Fear is not enmity. Enmity is hatred. It is war. It is opposition. It is an antagonism. An opposition that is real. And he says, "I'm going to create this between Satan and the woman first, the woman being Eve, and then between Satan, his seed, and a certain category of humanity, who is going to be known as the woman's seed, and finally between Satan and a certain person who will descend from the seed of the woman. So in verse 15, God is essentially saying to Satan, if you think you have ultimately won Eve's heart forever and the entire human race forever, you are wrong. There's good news that is following the bad news. And the good news is the gospel that God is going to rescue a huge group of people from out of Satan's clutches throughout all of human history, and is going to make them into His people through the work of His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, on the cross of Calvary. You see, God is denying Satan at the very moment and the very place when he assumed he had triumphed. God denies him what he thought he had gained. And so whereas Adam and Eve chose to love Satan and hate God in their act of disobedience, and by the way, don't think that that language is strong, because every time we sin, we do the same thing. We choose to love evil more than we love God. Which is to say, we choose to love that which is sin and hate God. That's why sin is so bad. That's why sin has to be judged. Sin is an attack upon God, upon His holiness, His righteousness, His sovereignty, everything about Him. And so, whereas Adam and Eve chose to love Satan and hate God, and chose to believe Satan and doubt God, so as to plunge the whole human race into this same kind of depraved heart loyalty to Satan and Satan's ways, it's not going to be permanent for the whole human race, because God is going to save and He's going to transform out of this sinful humanity a people for Himself, who will be so transformed that they will hate the serpent who is Satan, and they will love God. And there will be enmity between them and Satan, and even between them and Satan's seed, as the verse says. So God's going to create enmity between a people who are His people and those people who remain in Satan's dominion. God is going to reverse what Adam's sin has caused. And so here the gospel, the good news, makes its initial entrance into human history embedded in a prophetic curse on Satan. Now again, notice that God says He will first create enmity between Satan and the woman, who of course is Eve. We're talking about Eve. She's the only woman here. Well, this is not a general term for all women. It is talking specifically about Eve. And I think this is a promise of Eve's salvation, of Eve's redemption, if you will, which is going to result in her transformation from a woman who, instead of trusting and loving and obeying Satan, will be transformed into trusting and loving and obeying God. Eve will no longer see Satan as the one who fulfilled her desires, and God is the frustrator of her desires, as she thought He was. Now, you see this as you follow this whole story. In Genesis 3, you have Eve not trusting God, but trusting Satan. She doubts God and she trusts Satan. But then God makes the promise in Genesis 3:15, says that there will be someone that comes out of her seed that is going to reverse all this, going to reverse the curse. He's going to crush Satan. And then you see Eve becomes pregnant. And in Genesis 4:1, when she gives birth to a son, names him Cain, which means to acquire, to receive. And then she says, because I have gotten a man from the Lord. And if you look in your Bibles in Genesis 4:1, some of you have in your Bibles words in italics. If you have words in italics, it's because those words were not part of the original language. They were added by translators to help us understand the passage a little bit better. And so the idea in Genesis 4:1 is the man had relations with his wife Eve. She conceived, she gave birth to Cain, again, which means to acquire, to receive. And she said, I've gotten a man, the Lord. I've gotten the man, the deliverer. I've gotten the one who God has promised in Genesis 3:15. Now she's wrong. She didn't get him. But she believed the promise. Do you see the transformation? In Genesis 3, she's believing Satan. In Genesis 4, she's believing God. But she was wrong. Cain was not the deliverer. Abel's not the deliverer because Cain kills Abel. Cain is exiled. But then at the end of Genesis 4, you see something else very interesting. In verse 25, Adam had relations with his wife again, and she gave birth to a son and named him Seth, for she said, God has appointed me another seed. Offspring is seed. God has appointed me another seed in place of Abel, for Cain killed him. In other words, she's believing God. She's believing the promise. She has been transformed. From a woman who did not believe God in Genesis 3 to a woman who now believes God. We have a miracle that's happened right here. That's what happens. That's the difference between the seed of Satan and the seed of the woman, the seed of God. Those who are of God believe God. They trust God. They love God. They obey God. Yes, they still sin, but they repent. The seed of Satan don't care. It doesn't matter. What God says really is of no concern. God is of no concern. God doesn't matter. You know, as we're leaving for church today, and this is not to be construed as me saying that you have to be in church every Sunday. I'm not saying that. But I find it interesting that Bates College has its graduation on Sunday. Now, Peter and I were thinking this would be a great way to make a little money at our house, you know. Sell parking spaces. $25 a day, you can park in the driveway. Next time. But as I was watching all this going on there, I thought to myself, what an ultimate expression of we don't need you. We don't want you. We don't even recognize you. That's the seed of Satan. There are two humanities in this world, and you are a member of one of them. So am I. Listen, only people who have enmity for Satan, who hate him and are in opposition to him, are those who have been born again so as to be saved and transformed. You can't love Satan and the world and God at the same time. It's impossible. You're going to be at enmity with one or the other. But you can't have them both. James 4:7 says, before you can resist the devil, you must what? Submit to God. You can't resist the devil. You wouldn't want to resist the devil without first submitting to God. You must draw near to God. You can't have enmity with Satan and not be in a relationship with God. You have to have that enmity against Satan if you're in a relationship with God. But this work of transformation is going to go beyond Eve. He makes a promise. He says, I'm going to put enmity between you, Satan, that's who he's talking to, and the woman, Eve. But then he goes on, and between your seed and her seed. Now, Eve is going to have a seed. Satan has a seed. We have two humanities forming here. All starts here in Genesis 3:15. You have a humanity that belongs to the dominion of darkness, a humanity that belongs to the dominion of light. One belongs in the kingdom of Satan, one belongs in the kingdom of God. And they start to form right here, and the work of transformation is going to go beyond Eve. Because if you look down at verse 20, Eve is not Eve until verse 20. So she's just the woman in verse 15. She doesn't get her name Eve until verse 20. Now the man, that's Adam, called his wife's name Eve because she was the mother of all the living. Now keep in mind, Eve is going to be the mother of everybody. Okay, she's the first woman. So she's going to be the mother of everybody. But all the people that are born to Eve and all the descendants of Adam and Eve, because of Adam's fall, are going to be born spiritually dead. Spiritually depraved. No desire to come to God. No desire to... They don't want God. He's a non-issue for them. So everybody that's going to be born is going to be like this. But when Adam says that Eve is also the mother of all the living, what he is talking about are those people who are made spiritually alive by God so as to have enmity with Satan. She is going to be the mother of those who are spiritually alive. The humanity that belongs to God. These will be the seed of the woman in verse 15. They are the spiritual descendants of Eve, if you will, whom God is going to redeem from the fall and transform so as to love God and hate Satan. So out of Eve, who's the mother of all living souls, there's going to come a race of redeemed humanity that will also be at enmity with Satan and at enmity with Satan's seed. And they will love God, they will trust God, and they will hate Satan. Now, this doesn't mean that we treat unbelievers as enemies. We know that. We understand that. But it does mean that at our spiritual core, believers and non-believers are at odds with each other. Have you learned that? Have you experienced that? And for some of you, it's in your families. You cannot come to Christ and surrender to Christ and become Christ and not be at enmity with those who will not. There is opposition. There is antagonism. You are completely different at your very core in who you are. You don't treat them as enemies, but you cannot be together either. That's why Paul says in 2 Corinthians 6, 14 and 15 what he does. Look over there, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 14 and 15. It helps us understand why he says what he says. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 6, verse 14, "Do not be bound together with unbelievers. For what partnership have righteousness and lawlessness? What fellowship has light with darkness? What harmony has Christ with Belial? Or what has a believer in common with an unbeliever?" It's because we're two different humanities, two different peoples, with two different gods. Those that belong to Christ worship the true God. Those that are not in that kingdom have a false god. And so, just as Genesis 3:15 promises the transformation and redemption of Eve, it also promises the transformation and the redemption of people throughout human history who are simply known as the woman's seed. Out of Eve is going to come a redeemed humanity known as her seed, who's going to have the same hatred for Satan that she is going to have once God transforms her through the good news He's promising in verse 15. Okay, God's just given a promise. He's pronouncing judgment on the Satan, on the serpent, and He's also making a promise, and He still has to transform Eve. That's going to happen very shortly. And God is saying, and this is also going to happen to other people, and those people that are also transformed are going to be the seed of the woman. And it's all because of the good news in verse 15. And so now we get to the good news. Look at the end of the verse. Out of Eve's seed, someone else is going to come. You see a change of pronouns from plural to singular. It's not her seed anymore. It's he. Singular. It's talking about a person. It's talking about a male person who is going to come. It's going to come out of the seed of the woman. He is going to come. He is going to be bruised on His heel, but in being bruised on His heel, He is going to crush the head of Satan. He's going to crush Satan's program. He's going to crush Satan's plans. He's going to crush Satan's prerogatives. He's going to crush him. So again, God talking to Satan, he, this seed, this one shall bruise you on the head, crush you on the head is really what it says in Hebrew. And you shall bruise him on the heel. In other words, you will inflict a wound upon him, but it will not be permanent. He will permanently destroy you. This is the promise and the picture of the total defeat of Satan. And this is what Jesus does at the cross. When he pays the penalty for the sins of all those who will believe in him so as to rescue them from Satan's kingdom and place them in God's kingdom. Colossians 1, 13 and 14. Here's what it says. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. So you have the bad news in Genesis 3, 1 through 13, followed by the good news of the gospel in Genesis 3, 15, in which God, in promising to send a Redeemer who is going to crush Satan, will also bring about this great reversal to Satan's scheme to rob God of His glory. And in this verse, you basically have, in seed form, God's plan to redeem out of sinful humanity a people, a humanity for Himself. So as we come to a close, here's the really big question for all of us to ask and answer. Which humanity do you belong to? There's only two. Which one do you belong to? From Genesis 3:15, there are only two kinds of people in the world. I told you back when we started Genesis that very early in Genesis we're going to see there's only two kinds of people in the world. There are not Republicans and Democrats, Chinese and Americans, millennials, and whatever other generation you want to come up with, black and white, yellow and brown. There are only two kinds of people in the world. There's only two humanities in the world. The seed of the woman who are transformed so as to trust and love and obey God, and those who hate Him and want nothing to do with Him. And you're either a member of God's humanity or you're a member of Satan's. There's no neutral ground. And the only way that you are made a member of God's humanity is by surrendering to Him on His terms, not your terms. You come to God on His terms. Don't dare come to God on your terms. You have to come to Him on His terms, which is a total surrender. Total surrender. A total surrender of your love for and your loyalty to Satan and sin and yourself, so as to have Christ and the salvation He offers through His blood shed on the cross for any sinner who will surrender. You see, God has terms of surrender. No one is saved who does not surrender. The Bible says we are enemies of God before salvation. We were hostile to God before salvation. We're at war with God before salvation. And you must surrender. He only saves those who surrender. He only saves those who will admit they're sinners. If you're not a sinner, you don't qualify. Only sinners who will surrender will be transformed and placed into this new humanity. You're not in God's humanity, and you cannot be in God's humanity unless you come to Him on His terms and in His way, which is only by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, for the forgiveness of your sins, for God's glory alone. That's the only way. That's why Jesus said to his disciples, it's impossible for a man to come to him. It's impossible. No one ever would unless God does that work that He has to do. He has got to do that work. He's got to reveal to us the glory of Himself in the face of Christ. Break our hearts. In fact, give us a new heart so that we can see Christ and run to Christ. And so no one is in God's humanity and can be in God's humanity unless we come to Him on His terms and in His way, again, which is on His terms. There is no other way. You must surrender to God or you will perish. God said to the Apostle Paul in Acts 26, verses 17 through 18, He said, here's what God said to Paul. He said, I am sending you to the Gentiles to open their eyes. To open their eyes so that they will turn from darkness to light. And from the dominion of Satan to God. So that they will receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who are saved by faith. You're either in one humanity or the other. And in order to be transformed from the dominion of Satan to the dominion of God, your eyes need to be opened by the gospel and you need to come and surrender to Christ. Have your eyes been opened? Then come to Christ. Surrender. Have you already surrendered? Then live like the new humanity that you are. Let's pray and we'll celebrate communion. Father, we thank You for Your Word. We thank You for Genesis 3:15. Oh, may we recognize who are believers who have been transformed, who love You and who hate the dominion of darkness and hate the dominion of evil. Help us to realize that that didn't happen because we got up and made a decision one day. Help us to realize that happened because of what You did. And cause us to be thankful for the great mercy that You have had upon us and the grace that You have shown to us. And Father, may we recognize that You're not finished adding to Your kingdom yet. In fact, You tell us in Luke that there's plenty of room in heaven. And You want Your house filled with people who will glorify You and enjoy You forever. But that can only be accomplished when people will surrender to Christ. Oh Lord, I pray that You will work in hearts today that are in rebellion to You, that You will draw them home. And we will thank You. And for us who do know You, may You continue to do Your work of transformation. May You continue to do Your work of conforming us to the image of Your Son. And Father, we thank You for this communion table of which we are about to partake. We thank You that it is our remembrance of what You have accomplished through Your Son, the Lord Jesus, what He has accomplished on the cross for us, and what that means in our transformation. We thank You and we praise You. In Jesus' name, amen.